Watching your face, watching that, it's still tough to watch.
It is. I mean, it's... if this was just a story that Jeff Pope, our writer, had come up with, you'd think, God, that's awful. But the fact that it is, somebody has lived through that and still continues to do so, it's
horrific. You were very aware of that story at the time as well, weren't you?
Yes, yeah. I was living in the UK at the time and just... I just remember his face, as we all do, every news bulletin, every newspaper, and the sea of flowers around that the fir tree pub.
And the thing about Jeff Pope's writing, which is so wonderful, when he was in here, we were talking about the fact that we all saw those headlines, and it is your worst nightmare, every parent's worst nightmare. And yet, what you don't see is the story that lies beneath, and the families involved, and the repercussions that has on all of them, and that's what. This is their story.
Yeah.
The pressure on you as an actress to play that role, to play the mother, is huge.
Yes. There's. I'd be lying if I said there was no pressure, and there certainly is a huge responsibility because, as I said, this is somebody's worst nightmare, and you just want to get it right for them. I mean, if other people watch it and think it's good, fantastic. But that's all a bonus. That's. You know, as long as Melanie and Steve are happy with it, and I believe they are, then that's all we wanted, you know.
And they were very much on board from the beginning. This was very much their project, really. And you met with them early stages, didn't
you? We did, myself and Brian, who plays Steve, and Jeff, the writer and quadro producer, met with them in their house for an afternoon before we started filming, and they were very warm, welcoming, very honest and open with their story. We spoke an awful lot, actually, about the court case and how difficult that was for them on top of everything else. It was the guts of 3 months. It was 11 weeks.
Well, for you guys filming, it's a few days. For them, it was such a long time. And also because of the behaviour of the defendants, which when you read that script, you thought, oh, there's a little bit of dramatic licence going on here.
Absolutely. It was so... You read the script and how those boys were behaving in the dock, you kind of think, well, I mean, no human, no matter what you've done, you couldn't get yourself to that point. But they actually, in reality, they behaved as if they were up for petty theft, you know. And this courtroom, when I read the script, I envisaged some old Victorian courtroom with space where the victim's family would be far apart from the family of the accused. It is relatively small, and you are literally sitting shoulder to shoulder with parents of children who they've colluded in perverting the course of justice, and in doing so prolonged the agony for Mel and Steve.
And that scene that you're discussing there was one of the scenes that Steve and his son Owen came down to watch, because they sort of stayed away from the filming, which you can understand, but they did make the decision to come down and watch that. And you thought that was probably one of the toughest scenes for them to watch back, really.
Certainly. There was an open invitation for Mel and Steve to come down and watch film whenever they wanted, but the very nature of the piece meant every day would be a difficult day. But Steve and Owen came down into that courtroom, which was the actual courtroom where the trial
unfolded,
took place. And I remember, you know, Steve was on set and I was watching him and Owen thinking, my God, this particular scene that we were filming, as we were saying, was the scene where the boys were behaving like animals. Mm. And I thought, God, that's so close to the bone, should they be watching it? But Steve apparently said to Quadra, our producer, look, that is exactly how it was, and I'm glad you're portraying it so people can see.
My brave them.
When we were talking to Jeff and he came in here and said it was absolutely vital that it was shot in Liverpool, and even now everyone is very protective over Mel and Steve, aren't they? And you found that in cabs and things.
Absolutely. You'd whether it be in a cab or a shop or a restaurant, and people say, well, what are you doing here? And you'd explain and blah blah blah, and immediately there was a wall up. And you know, you'd be questioned, well, hang on, how do the family feel about this? Are they aware? And as soon as they knew, that yes, it's okay, Mel and Steve have been involved for years. They could not do enough. Mm. They could not do enough for us. They were brilliant.
And the message of it is this: the futility of the violence within these gangs and the impact it has on an entire community, on the devastation on family. You said it's a nuclear effect on the family.
Absolutely. It's you don't get over it. You don't, even with, you know, a guilty verdict. Mm. There's no full stop. Mel and Steve still have to live every morning, every day, not having their son with them, and no guilty verdict is going to bring him back. Yeah. And it just shows that, as you said, that nuclear impact. Yeah.